I'm going to talk about how do you measure the innovative creative pulse of a city? How do you measure that? And that hopefully ties into something about knowledge hubs and so on. So let's look at that more closely. Now, the basic thing about knowledge hubs is really, and about cities that we might deem to be creative or so, is places that generate the conditions for people to think, plan, and act with imagination. And what you really need is obviously to harness that collective imagination of a city. And I heard a Swedish guy speak recently, an economist, and he was saying, he was asked the question, why are you so inclusive in Sweden? And the person was slightly sneering. And he said, we've got no other option. We've only got about 10 million people, so we better be inclusive vis-a-vis America, who's got 300 million people. You can choose one in 30. In Sweden, we have to have everybody, because otherwise we can't compete. So this question of harnessing the collective imagination, I do think is quite important. Now, I'm using the word creativity, and I know this is called cities of innovation, and there is a reason, because I think the first point is in order to generate that atmosphere that generates the interest and all the things that we need ultimately, you need an environment that encourages curiosity. And particularly if we think about the 20% unemployed people in the western suburbs, how are they going to be a contributor to all this innovative Sydney that you're talking about? So the strategy of curiosity is someone's task. So I don't know whose, but someone's. If they are curious people, then obviously they're likely to be imaginative. If they're imaginative, they might have some creative ideas. And if that happens, out of the 10 ideas, 3 may be useful and may become inventions, out of which an innovation happens, which generates further curiosity. So the first point I'm really making is it's very, people don't tend to talk about the innovative city anymore, because increasingly people, Leicester in Britain, just as an example, say, what are the preconditions for the innovation to happen? Now, this thing I'm talking about is actually ultimately about all these words that you can see I'll go back, sorry, that went a bit too quickly. That the ecology of a city requires innovations at all sorts of different levels. We heard today from Mark about the different things about demographic changes and all of that, and he had a slide with about the word change 50 times on it. But there are just various levels of innovation that we need to be thinking about, which is both the physical environment, the business models, but also all sorts of others, including how bureaucracies might work, which I talked about earlier. And I think when I'm thinking about your precinct, which of course is not a precinct, perhaps it is, but it's 6 major spots, one could think of it in a certain sense, partly as an R&D zone. Now, my summary, as I've already just said there, is that a place that may be innovative creates opportunities imaginatively, but also solves any problem imaginatively. That's why I found it very interesting today in the conversation about trying to get beyond this binary thinking that we had a lot. On the one hand, this we can't do that, this is a problem, and so on. I basically am pretty convinced that when one brings the parties together in the right way, one can find solutions. And I think this is obviously a good event in beginning that process. Now, the origins of this Creative City Index thing that I'm now going to outline was when Bilbao said something, they used practically these words, but it's very interesting. They said, we know we are an innovative city. It's the richest area, the Basque Country, and the richest city per capita in Spain. They have incredibly good at advanced manufacturing, but they said, we know we're an innovative city, but we're not sure we're creative, because we don't think we're generating enough IP, intellectual property, to generate our future wealth. Now, they understood, sorry, I know you understand the difference, between creativity and innovation, because creativity is the precondition of that. So there are 10 areas that we tend to look at. And the origins of this thing, the only other word I'll say, is we looked at all the sort of benchmarking things around the world, and we've described and heard many today. The difference between how we measure it, and I think it's quite important, is it's both subjective and objective. So what we'd gather together is that what people think from different types of stakeholders about their place with an external view, and then we marry those. And what becomes really interesting in that process is that that becomes the strategic conversation, because we've done this in about 20 cities, Helsinki, places like that. And what you find is there's a difference, and that difference is the nub of then the conversation that is about where does one go strategically. So these 10 domains we cluster, I suppose, into four areas. How do you nurture and identify the potential of a place? And the first thing that is really, in looking at everything, is for a place to become innovative ultimately, it is about openness, a predisposition to be more open than closed. I'm not saying being 24/7 open, but open enough rather than closed. That could be open to new ideas and all of that. Trusting. So that's about being psychologically open, the buildings feeling open. I'm going to come back to that later. Are these buildings that say no, or are these buildings that say yes? Some people ask me about my methodology, and I say, I've got a very complicated methodology in assessing cities. It's basically yes and no. Does it feel more yes, or does it feel more no? Which is why I think practically everyone is a good urban designer, because we roughly know that. So the first precondition of an innovative place is to be disposed to be open. The second domain or field in this first area is really about, open. This is just, you know, open to different cultures and so on. The second area is to look at the learning landscape. And the learning landscape, I think, is beyond, I think university is obviously important, schools are important, all of that is incredibly important. But the learning landscape of a city is much wider, because people learn in all sorts of ways beyond just being at a university. I suppose we're co-learning now in this event, and you're not in universities. Obviously, universities are important. But creating an environment where learning is seen as a part of everyday life. And cities that seem to do well are both good at the formal, the institutions we know about, but also informal, professional development, all those sorts of things. But particularly what one finds is, and the word collaboration has been used a lot, is that these institutions, these learning institutions, for example, universities, themselves are open. Now, we've heard some good examples of universities that are open, but in my opinion, and I hope I'm not offending anyone, there are many universities who are more concerned with themselves than being as open as they might be. And importantly, is whether they are bedded into the city. And it's been quite interesting that over the last year, 2 years, I've been asked to do a couple of projects about universities and science parks. They're often connected, for example, in Oulu in Finland, where the mobile phone was invented, Taipei and other places, where they've said, we've got a lot here, but what we want is urbanity. How can you create urbanity in a setting that is a science park? So if one is going to go in any of these directions, there has to be urbanity. Even the person who's in a, you know, doing in some sort of lab, they do actually want to do the things that people do in normal life as well. So the learning landscape could be obviously a library like here and so on. And just because the Minister of Health was here a moment ago, I've put this in UTS. Now, the only issue I would raise here, that UTS says it's an incredible school of health and so on, so I'm just interested where this new thing will happen. Now, the interesting thing about UTS, I happened to walk past there on Sunday, is you can see some of the competitive resources even universities are using, which is, in fact, using buildings to attract talent. And so that is a relatively new phenomenon. Obviously, we know that cities in general, but universities in particular, are much more interested in that, far more interested than they used to be. The second area, field, cluster of issues is how do you enable and support the potential that you might find in a city? And here are three fields or domains that we assess. And the first is the political and public framework, the level of strategic agility, and how professional and effective. And what's very important about this is normally when we talk about innovation, creativity, imagination, one never links it to that other side of it, which is how professional are you in actually making it happen? Because a creative idea that isn't implemented is not that interesting in that sense. So these are then, this is the next cluster of issues. So the first, in terms of the political framework, the sort of things we assess is, what is the rules and incentives regime? And quite often what one finds, in my experience, I don't know what yours is that people say something like, okay, let's think of a vision, and then someone there will say, well, these are the rules, and this is what bounds, is the boundary of what you're going to discuss, rather than saying, for example, if a transport planner and a couple of others came together saying, oh, wait, okay, what makes a great street, that we discuss what makes a great street, and then we say, ah, do the rules need to be adjusted to make the great street? So that's one element of rethinking some of the rules and regulations. And obviously the usual things about thinking how the actual system itself works. So that's incredibly important. And the messages that come out from the political structure are absolutely key in this process. So this is obviously about dealing with the spaghetti problem or red tape problem and rethinking some of the regulations as well. And this is where I think this question I raised earlier today about the bureaucracy is incredibly important, because it's about often saying less about law but shifting the bureaucratic thing more to what are the principles, the intent of the law. So it's more about the spirit of the law rather than the letter of the law. And this issue is really a global issue, which has words like how do we rethink governance and so on. And there are lots of examples which we can discuss later of where this is happening. And it's very interesting that quite often I've found in cities there's something that is a recommendation, but because we're all too lazy, we treat it as law. And therefore, we break out and reduce the flexibility within a system. And therefore, the system, this bureaucratic system, is drained of life and flexibility. The implication of what I've just said is that the individual official and so on has to take more judgment. The next area within this domain about supporting is strategic agility. So that is all about, I mean, the phrase there you can see is to be strategically principled but tactically flexible. Quite often, again, it's trying to get beyond this thing of seeing everything in this simplistic step-by-step way. And strategically principled means clearly we know roughly where we're going, but we know that life is more like this. But if we have our principles, we're going to get into, at least we're doing roughly the right thing. So it's a good sorting device. Within that, of course, this strategic question is the thing that I raised earlier today, which is about the power of trying to tell a compelling story. And the reason why that's so important is how do you deal with the tensions which are inevitable in any urban development city-making project? And therefore, you know, typically it starts off with where are the cars going to go? That, of course, needs to be parked. Because unless, once you get the compelling story, of course, then the car parking will solve itself. So this often involves various partners coming together in ways they might not wish to. But here, this was a photo, and fortunately they've cut off the head of this guy. I just walked out of a hotel in Canada and suddenly saw this picture and thought, ah, there are three forms of leadership. Ordinary leadership, which perhaps just provides car parking. I know car parking is important. Innovative leadership that does interesting things, and in a sense visionary leadership, which finds a way of describing what needs to happen in a way that difference can resolve itself a bit. The final point in this segment is about professionalism and effectiveness, which is all about this question of predictability, continuity, which is absolutely essential. Because although creativity or discussions about imagination always seem to be floating in the air a bit and so on, it needs to be bounded by its opposite, because otherwise none of this makes sense. And part of that, this is Paris. These are all their reports on their sustainability issues. But anyway, what it's about is doing rather than only writing reports. And it is about that question whether different partners can trust each other, which we've partly hinted at today and indeed yesterday. The next area is how do we exploit this potential? If you're looking at a place, so firstly you need to identify, nurture it, support and enable it, then exploit and harness it. And here the key issues that we explore is the level of entrepreneurship that is allowed, and by that I mean social entrepreneurship as well as other forms of obviously business entrepreneurship, and as well the issue that's come up, which is about connections, physical connections and other forms of connections. So in the first, this thing about entrepreneurship, it's all about, is there a hard and soft infrastructure that supports that? Are there incubator units? Are there, we just had a conversation, are there 1,000 young startups somewhere here in these buildings and so on, that sort of thing. Is this validated? Is it, it's just interesting again to mention the thing about Helsinki. In the past, if you were a young company like Rovio who do Angry Birds and you said, I'm a startup, people thought you didn't have a job. This was classically the Finnish thing. You haven't got a job, you're a startup. However, now it's all the thing to be, which is why I mentioned this morning, slash the event, which I gather this moment, precisely 11,000 people are talking about. It's the biggest startup event in Europe. And so just as an example, how many people work in Angry Birds? Just give me a number. Come on, give me a number, please. I'm alone here. What? 200? All right. 650. But it is quite interesting, isn't it? Just a sort of game, which is 650 people there working. And where do they come from? And we know it's very dark today. It's already dark. It's only probably 2 o'clock in the afternoon. They come, the main head of animation comes from Colorado. There's a Korean, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So this is obviously very important. And that incubation point is partly what I'm talking about. But there can be also civic creativity. This is outside Bilbao. And I never thought you could have an escalator in the rain going up the hill helping you. No, it's great, isn't it? I thought, this can't work. It's not going to work. The rain's going to get in there. But all I'm saying, there are various forms of entrepreneurship, including civic entrepreneurship. Then there's the issue of connectivity, which we've talked about a lot today. But I would say the key word there at the bottom, beyond the obvious words about physical and social connectivity, which is partly finding ways for people of different groupings to meet and so on, is really communication capacity. Because many of the strategic decisions, as you well know, I remember American Express was at one point asking where should Asia's Pacific headquarters be, and the issue was, well, how many people can speak whatever languages we need? So that is an incredibly important part of a creative place. So that's obviously about getting out of silos and so on, connecting different forms of disciplines. This is a map, wherever this is, of knowledge. You don't need to know much. All you need to know is Sydney needs all this knowledge, but it's all separate in its own ways. And we've already talked about the crossovers earlier today as a key issue in that. But also we need to look at, and sorry, the next six slides or so you would have seen this morning, so I apologize, is there are different forms of sharing knowledge, one of which are the TEDx type events. And there are many other different forms as well that are all part of this process. But then, I'm sorry, this is not you, don't worry, this is not Sydney, but it could be. But the forms of connectivity and how we move from A to B is obviously an absolutely key thing. And Joe and others have already said that walkability and things like that are absolutely key in that. The final thing is how we live and express this potential. Because in order to force feed it back into a sort of system that, which is like a virtuous cycle, you need to experience it as you're being there. Because if all this was happening and it's all behind closed doors and you can't see it, then, you know, it may as well not be happening, or it doesn't help inspire people. And so here the three issues are around distinctiveness, the place and how it is being made, and livability. So in terms of the first, and we've discussed this already today, the question of how unique and special and specific a place is absolutely key in this, because we all know about the baseline facilities that every city needs to have, good airports and all of that. But the question is, what makes the difference is the difference. And increasingly, cities that are operating on a scale like Sydney need to be at that level, which is really the difference that really does something special. So that's about, obviously, identity and so on. Or you might say the soul of the city. It's just interesting, this is a church, by the way. But in fact, it's been turned into a nightclub, which is a bit depressing. The next area, and I'm nearly finished, is about the place and placemaking. Many cities are not very interesting, but what they're doing is very interesting. On the other hand, there are many cities that are already interested and what they're doing is less interesting. So both what exists and what is happening is incredibly important. And that's why I made the point that, in a sense, the new and the old, heritage and what is new, are wonderful partners in creating great places. And what here is quite interesting, so often when we think of great places, we think of the amazing thing. Well, actually, it's a blend of the unbelievably ordinary, 100 houses well done and interesting looking could itself be the equivalent of a big thing. And obviously, there are issues about avoiding the chain culture, you know, having, I don't know how many McDonald's there are now, I've lost count, I think, not that I've counted them, but I think there are 33,000. But anyway, I don't know if that's the same word in Australian chain culture, we use that in Britain. So there, I'm just using Bilbao because we did the initial work there. So then the final thing, and this is often what the things about evaluating places focuses on, is livability and well-being. And of course, that's absolutely essential. But I hope you've seen that we've tried to then add other dimensions in our assessment to try and create a slightly more richer set of issues, which is all about livability, is obviously about affordability, rich facilities, and so on. And because the health minister was here earlier, she's not here. Oh, is she? Ah, hello. I didn't realize you, I thought you'd gone. I'm so pleased you're here. Yes, but forgive me if I don't mention Roosevelt Island. Right, okay, that's great. Because I was just thinking that when we think about a health zone or a zone which is about innovation in this, there are a couple of issues I just wanted to focus on, and I showed this earlier. Because I think, you know, this is the classic old hospital. So whatever it physically looks like, you know, the incinerator doesn't help. You know, I remember once someone said to me, why when I feel so ill is this incinerator so near the entrance? Do you see what I mean? So I know you don't build your hospitals like this anymore. And that's why I also showed this thing about the Court of Justice I won't tell you where that is, and the one in Adelaide, which was different. Now, the point about this is I think that if one's got a centre, a place, whether it's in Roosevelt Island or wherever it is, that is about, in some sense, well-being, it has to resonate through its physical structure and every signal, because the city is a communications device. Everything is communicating. This stand is communicating, everything. And therefore, this thing, whatever you do, has got to resonate in an unbelievable way. So this was why I was talking earlier today about the walking thing. So it should really be a walking district. Now, just a few questions to leave you with. The issue is, I thought it was, you were very persuasive when you talked earlier and you went boom, boom, boom. I thought, Christ, this is all happening. My head was spinning. But before you actually have the reputation for that, what do you do to generate that magnetism, that resonance effect that is required? And I think here is this issue about communications comes back into it. And I'm not saying you should do this, but I'm just using this because I was there recently, the SAMRI building in Adelaide, and I've done it in such a way that it doesn't look so nice so that you feel you could do better. So I've done that one. This one's a bit better. But you get the idea that this centre, which is about well-being and all sorts of other things, is trying to send a message out through the way it looks, because actually that's what also obviously the Geary building is trying to do for the business students, the building you obviously know about. Although I'm not sure whether the back from a feng shui perspective is very good, because from a feng shui perspective, Geary really didn't get it, yeah? It's completely jarring, very negative from a Chinese perspective. The other bit's okay. So here I'm saying, what you know is labs. You normally can't go into a lab. I mean, when I was in the SAMRI building, there are rows and rows of labs. Of course you can't go in there. And what you see is just a, you know, you see things like that, and behind there are these people working. And the results of what many of them are doing, of course, very interesting. And so the question here is, how do we, this is inside the SAMRI building, how do we show the interesting stuff? How do we make the invisible visible in the physical environment that is a health zone or something like that? And this is where I think you've got a wonderful opportunity to do this, to just rethink, not rethink, but just think about what it all looks and feels like as it unfolds. And I think that's an interesting challenge. I'm only showing you this. I'm not saying you should do this, but this is Arts Electronica in Linz. And I've been involved in arts and science projects for 15 years, a big project in funded by Glaxo Wellcome, where we brought scientists together, because you talked a lot about various people. But one grouping which we funded, or Glaxo funded, Wellcome funded, was collaborations between artists and scientists, not for the artist to paint a scientist, but through the different insights they have to solve problems, whatever the problem was. And I think this is a great opportunity. So in Arts Electronica in Linz, you just walk past and you suddenly see your own liver, and I don't think you want to look at that anymore. Thank you very much. But the other thing on that, just a brief reminder, is this is something called the Footprint, and I was invited to the Innovation Festival in Novosibirsk, which is in Siberia. So you think, okay, Siberia. Now, that is next to Akademigorodok. And Akademigorodok was their Silicon Valley, but it's in the middle of nowhere. And this festival, what it did, was bring out into the streets in an incredibly interesting way all the innovations that were happening inside. And that's very important in terms of getting public agreement for the things that we all need. So what I'm really saying is have a sensory precinct, one that fits the senses. And I remember once I was absolutely exhausted and I was in Edinburgh and I was just thinking, my God, I can't cope anymore. And then I went to the sensory garden, the smell garden, and I thought I was having aromatherapy. Now, I think part of the strategy here has got to be things like sensory gardens, just to show that this is that you're just thinking, you know, quite broadly about what is possible. And I'm not saying you should do any of this, but just somehow how that is put together should be different. So finally, I've got 8 seconds left. I sometimes think children's hospitals are quite interesting to look at, because those are the only hospital environments I've seen where people often think a bit laterally. And that's it. Thank you very much.